my juicy co-creators, Lilou here on the Juicy Living Tour in beautiful Amsterdam in Holland with Baptiste de Pape. Hello, Baptiste.
Hey, Lilou, how are you?
So good to have you on camera and do this interview today.
It's my pleasure.
I'm very, very excited about the book coming out and the movie. This is so special after 5 years of hard labor, can we say?
Yes, you can say that.
Yeah. It's been a lot of work, hasn't it?
It's been a big, big project, and I produced this with a big team, so yeah.
Yeah. I'm excited to speak of the content of this book, of course, and the message and why you did that. But what I find really inspiring is your story, because you're like one of us. You had this job, actually, well, you're a lawyer. You did amazing studies, and then you were... Somebody proposed the job, but you decide, no, this is not what I want to do. I have another calling. Tell us about that moment in your life.
Yeah, I was always looking for my purpose in life. And, you know, with the logical thinking, I couldn't find it. And one day I saw a show, a web class hosted by Oprah Winfrey. And in that show, she was hosting Eckhart Tolle. Uh-huh. And Oprah said, there's actually nothing more important than finding your purpose in life. And I said, yes, that's true. That's exactly what I'm looking for. What is my purpose in life? And Eckhart replied, he said, it is perfectly all right to ask, what do I want from life? But if you really want to find your purpose in life, you have to ask, what does the bigger picture want from me? So what does life want from me? And I started meditating on that question, what does life want from me?
And so you were open to meditation and already those techniques you had been reading.
Yeah, I always thought that, you know, the logical thinking that we are taught in schools is very limited. And I always felt that intuition is something, is a kind of intelligence and wisdom that we are not taught how to tap into that. Mm-hmm. So I was always interested in meditation and spirituality, yeah.
Are all the Dutch men like you? Because you're Dutch, right?
I wish that all the Dutch men were like me, but no, it's not the case. No, I'm happy that everyone is different, actually. So I embrace that, yeah.
I see, as I travel throughout Europe, I really see a lot of countries awakening. Is this part for you of the awakening? It goes through the awakening of the heart?
I feel that the heart is our biggest source of intelligence, our biggest source of wisdom. And I don't know if it's about awakening. I just think it's about acknowledging that and recognizing that this is a source that we want to connect with. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I love what Maya Angelou that is in your movie. I mean, you have so powerful teachers, Maya Angelou, Paulo Coelho, Eckhart Tolle. All these guys are in there. I mean, you've attracted that. You made it happen, and you were reading their books, and now it came into a movie. It's not even a documentary. Yeah, it's a movie. Very powerful. The music, all of it. Oh my God, I'm so excited about it. I'm excited of its impact. What was the process like for you? You know, because you've never done a movie before. That's huge. You come from a law school. I guess you didn't learn that there, did you?
No, I did. I didn't learn that. And I think that actually, looking back at it, I think it was actually an advantage. Because I really had to tap into my intuition in order to make this happen, in order to manifest this. And I didn't know anyone in film, so I really started from scratch. And I think it was a big, big, big advantage that I didn't know how to make a film. Mm. Yeah.
And when you say intuition, you mean the first thing that you do is to just realign with yourself, huh? Yeah. Isn't that's really important? So you spend a lot of time in nature, from my understanding.
Yes, everyone has a different way of connecting. Everyone connects in a different way with their intuition, with their heart. For me, the best way is just walking in nature and also cultivating gratitude. And so I really do that combination. I walk in nature, and then at the same time, I start to appreciate, and I start to be grateful, and I start to evoke that feeling inside my body. Yeah.
There is fear is mentioned in the book and in the movie. Yeah. It's something that all of us face, and stress. We live stressful lives. We're in the in big cities sometimes. Yeah. What is your recommendation, and how did you move yourself throughout fear, out of fear?
The first step is, you know, when you feel fearful, acknowledge that and accept it, and don't fight it. and, you know, just realize it. And then the second step is, okay, you know, what am I going to do about it? And I think the second step is to align yourself with the feelings of love and appreciation again. So you have to figure out how you do that, because everyone has a different way of doing that. And for me, it's just, you know, if I really feel fearful, I just say, okay, I stop doing whatever I'm doing, and I make it a priority to align with the feelings of love again. And you know how it feels to be connected again. You know how it feels to be aligned again. So I'm looking for that feeling.
And sometimes it takes a lot. It could mean maybe days and days without working or being productive the old way, no?
Yeah. I think that if you don't make it a priority to align yourself with love again, then you don't have so much to give to yourself or to the world anyway. It's like, you know, the oxygen mask. If you're in an airplane and the oxygen masks are coming down, you have to give yourself the oxygen first, because otherwise you're not really helpful for other people. Yeah.
A little earlier on, I was mentioning Maya Angelou, and when I was thinking of that, I forgot to ask you, is actually, I love the sentence in the trailer when she says, you know, the heart is the only thing you can trust. She's got that great voice too, isn't she? I mean, that's so true. The heart is ultimately the only thing that truly we can count on, or?
Well, I think you have to see it this way. It's good. You know, in our education system, we are taught to do everything by logical thinking, to do everything by the mind, and that's good because we need that. But I think there is a higher perspective, a higher wisdom, and that's the power of the heart. And if you want to understand what it really is, then you have to see yourself on a river. If you are on a river, then from the mind's perspective, you can only see the next bend on the river. But the heart has a much higher perspective and can see the whole journey from source to see. So the heart can see things from a much bigger perspective. So the challenge is to learn to trust the heart. And that's the biggest challenge. Yeah. Because we are really always inclined to trust our mind and to trust our thinking. But that's okay. But it's just a very limited perspective.
Yeah.
Compared to the heart.
Yeah. A lot of teachers, I mean, this is very ancient knowledge. And did you dig into that? Because this is something that we've read about, we've heard, and yet our society, this is not a heart-based civilization that we live in, you know? There's
I think we have to work on ourselves. What society is doing is, in the first place, none of my business, really. You have to be the change you want to see in the world. If I see bad things in society, I have to work on myself first. Mm. Because if I don't work on myself first, how can I change it? Mm. So I think that's an important thing. So if I want to change the world, I first have to open my own heart. I have to work on myself. I have to become the person that I want, you know, that I want other people to be, you know? Because there's no, I mean, if you're going to complain about society and the world and not work on yourself first, then, I mean, what are you doing, actually, you know? So, but I think, yes, we are not living in a heart-based society. And it is also because the knowledge of the heart has been denied and it doesn't get the attention that it deserves, I think, yeah. So that's why we are making this movie, to show that there is a wisdom and that there is an intelligence in our heart, and that we want to learn to connect with that and tap into that, because it moves us to our higher potential. It moves us to our full potential. Paulo Coelho, one of the interviews in the movie, he says, you will never, ever reach your full potential if you don't open your heart. And that's true.
The timing seems perfect of the movie too, isn't that quite well, when we follow that kind of guidance, that higher guidance, that wisdom of the heart? I mean, 60 countries, I hear, are actually, this, your book is being spread, and the movie, all around the world. This is a huge phenomenon. This doesn't usually happen. How do you explain that?
I can't explain it, but I'm happy that it's happening. I think, If I'm gonna explain it, I think a lot of people are thirsty for this. A lot of people want this. A lot of people say, "Hey, I need this because I don't feel I'm tapping into my full potential. I'm not happy. I don't feel that I have the tools to live the best life that I want to live." And I think that's the reason. Yeah.
A big step, a big portion of the movie, or at least a portion of the movie, is on forgiveness around the story of Immaculée in Rwanda. So profoundly touching, the story. Oh my God, you really live through her, and you're already, I found myself starting to forgive so many people already, or and even ourselves, isn't it? Doesn't that start from there? I love her story. Tell us why you decided to have her. I know you worked with Drew Harriet on the movie, the director of The Secret, but and he probably was part of that, of choosing that, but why did you go for it?
What is your question? You really want to know,
yeah,
why
Immaculée, like, what, why does it describe so well for you the power of the heart? Why did you choose this story?
I think it's a really powerful story because she's in a situation where most of the people never get into that situation. And Marianne Williamson, one of the interviews, says, whenever I have a difficult time forgiving, I think about Immaculée Iliba Giza, because she really stretches the concept of forgiveness. Mm-hmm. Because most of the time we have problems forgiving our neighbors or our family members for something. And then afterwards we think, oh my God, it's silly. But we were holding all the toxicity of the anger the whole time. She's in a situation where she's put under so much pressure, where she just has to forgive in order to survive, because she is basically angry with 8 million people and she wants to kill them.
She's stuck in a bathroom for 3 months. Yeah. Can you imagine a small little bathroom and just, all the density.
Yes, and she is so angry, and she starts to realize that she has a choice. Yeah. She can stay angry and hold all the fear, or she can choose love. Mm. And she says, that was such a transformational insight that I could change. And she makes the change. And because she chose to make a change in herself, she is now inducing people with that energy. Mm. So that's why I think it's such a powerful story. And it helps me. You told me that when you saw it, it helped you to work on yourself.
I found myself forgiving already in the movie and having this, and I had shivers throughout the movie. I mean, I feel it's a healing movie. It heals you in itself. That's something that really was really, really special to me. There is this, it seems like it's God, source, life is there, has moved you, has helped you. You can feel it. You can feel the presence. Something else is happening in that movie that I found quite special. I've never seen before. So well done for getting out of the way. Isn't that part of our job, to kind of get out of the way?
Yes, it is. You have to get out of the way. Have to get out of your ego, your small-minded thinking. Yeah. And you have to say, okay, I want to be a vessel to my heart, to my intuition. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Tell us of the connection between the heart and the soul. How do you see it?
Well, I think that the heart is the seed of the soul. We can feel the heart.
That's a book of Gary Zukav, isn't it?
That's a book of Gary Zukav, but I really feel that the heart is really the temple of our soul. Yeah. That's where our soul lives. Mm. Yeah.
And the relationship between the brain and the heart?
Well, we have some research from the HeartMath Institute in our movie. We have Roland McGrady from the HeartMath Institute and Howard Martin. And what they're basically showing, and it's also being shown in the book, is that if you open your heart, if you are grateful, if you have the experience of love, it opens up your brain. So it's scientifically proven now that you're actually using more of your brain capacity when you're experiencing the feelings of love, happiness, compassion. So you're actually more intelligent when you're connected with your heart. Mm. So you're using more of your potential. Yeah.
I was very inspired lately about the movie Lucy, you know, where it says we're only using 10% and those dolphins are using 20%. What it would be like if we would use 100%. Do you think that's the key? Opening the heart actually opens up then our brain potential, our capacity?
Yes. Yes.
Psychic abilities. What do you think opens up?
I think it opens up our connectedness with our soul, with who we really are, with our higher self, with our full potential. Yeah. Yes.
So you chose 18 teachers throughout the movie. Why did you choose those? Because I know that some didn't make the cut.
Yes.
Why so? Why ultimately these 18, not 12?
Well, in the first place, when you make a movie, you always have to kill your darlings, because you can only make a movie You know, the movie has to be 90 minutes or 80 minutes. And so it's always a big, big challenge because you have to kill your darlings. But I think we chose the ones we chose because they were really infused with this energy of the heart. They were really talking from a very powerful place. So I think that's why we chose them. Mm. Yeah.
It seems like we have to make these choices now in our lives to kind of do some cleanup, or not even cleanup, but just go for the really the highest vision that we have. That's part of making a movie, I guess.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Following the vision that you originally received in a park. Yes. Was that in a park that it kind of, yes. You were really clear, weren't you, on that day?
Yeah. I mean, I was asking myself the question, what does life want from me? And in the beginning, nothing really happened. I said, okay, you know, I have to send Eckhart Tolle an email because this is not working. But I stayed with that question, and eventually it did happen. And I felt like my heart was opening. I really felt like, wow, this is such a powerful impulse. Mm. And it was so powerful. I felt so much love that I said, okay, I have no choice but to do it. And I was actually relieved that I knew what I had to do. For the, you know, with my life at that point, because of course you only know what you need to do at that moment, and you only need to know what you need to do at that moment, not for the rest of your life, of course. Yeah.
So it's very much being present in the present moment, being in the heart, feeling in line, following our intuition.
I think if I would describe it, you really have to follow that which makes you come alive. And you know how it feels to be really connected, to really feel the aliveness. You have to follow the aliveness. And when I asked that question, what does life want from me? And I felt that powerful impulse from my heart. I felt such a big aliveness that I had no choice but to follow that.
I was very surprised by Mark Nepo, that you found out that was there on your journey. Tell us why you decided to have him, because he's the big star, I felt, of this movie. Huh? He's really such a strong teacher.
Yes. Well, I think Mark Nepo lived through a lot. You know, he had a brain tumor. He had cancer several times. And this forced him into the journey from the head to the heart. He said the longest journey you will ever take is from the head to the heart. And for him, it meant almost dying to make that journey. Mm. And you really feel that he has lived through that whole journey. And that's why I think he has become such a powerful teacher.
Mm. Do we have to go through suffering to get there?
Well, from all the interviews I did, I noticed that most of the people that we've interviewed went through a crisis first in order to tap into their hearts. I think it is because of the following reason. I think that we all try to live the conventional way, you know, the way we are taught by our parents and by our schools. And then in our life, something happens that really crushes us, that really makes us rethink the way we are living. And we're basically saying, oh my God, the way I've been taught to live doesn't work anymore. And I have no other options than to explore if there's another way, if there's another intelligence or wisdom I can go to now in order to live my life. So they all didn't have a choice, actually. It happened. Life caused them to connect with their hearts.
As Nepo said, otherwise in the movie, he says, otherwise it crushes you, you know, life just crushes you, and there's no life then. There's no aliveness. And we're otherwise this competitive, fearful kind of human beings.
Yeah, when we're going through really tough times, our mind says, no, I don't want this. This is unfair. And you start to become a victim. But the heart says, give me more. Give me more. That's exactly what Mark Nepo says. The heart says, give me more, because it feels that, you know, it's the soul is growing through those experiences, and you are growing. But your mind says, no, I don't want this. It's terrible. And why is this happening to me? But the heart says, give me more. Yeah.
What is your wish for this movie? If you had a magic wand, what would you do?
I hope that if people watch this movie, that it opens their hearts and that they resonate with it, and it will support them in tapping into the intelligence and wisdom of their heart.
Last little thing I wanted to mention, because I don't know if you realize, if you already got the book that just that is out now, but you see this little mandala, this beautiful mandala. If you put it on your little bedside table, it actually glows at night. Oh my God, I love this detail. Little details like that that I saw throughout the movie as well. Congratulations for such a powerful coming out.
Thank you so much, Lilou. It was a
pleasure. This is big.
Yes.
Much love, my delicious co-creators. Hope you have enjoyed this video. Get the book. Oh my God, watch the movie. So, so special, so delicious. The whole family should see it. Friends, family, just let it all over the internet, all over internationally. I hope your heart is blossoming and that you're living your full potential right now in this present moment. Much love, my delicious co-creators. Bye-bye.